Josh. I'm gonna listen.
Hi everyone, we have a special treat for you. We're going to hop into game two between Dream and TLO. Dream is already up one. Let's see how things turn out. We're gonna hand it over to the casters and check out this game.
Thanks very much, Rachel. Welcome to the caster's desk, as we do have myself and Apollo ready to go into Dream versus TLO.
That's right. The Stefano Grubby game is still coming your way. Don't worry. It's in about 20 minutes' time. But since we're here, why not just cover this game instead of some downtime? It's going to be TLO versus Dream. TLO not having the best start to this tournament so far. 0-2 versus Stefano. Currently 0-1 versus Dream. But Dream, guys, you saw him in the Intellistry Masters Katowice tournament. How good was he? Second place in that tournament,
yeah.
And he's here looking pretty good himself today.
He was one of the players that I pegged going into this tournament to actually perform extremely well, and he hasn't disappointed thus far. As well, we are going to be jumping into game number two here against TLO himself, as we now have both of the players ready to go on Aklan Wastes.
Look at that young face there, Kolaris, 16-year-old. Big stage again. We questioned him actually in Katowice. Could he perform on a big stage? And boy, did he. That's a pretty big stage there.
Yeah, very impressive indeed. So, like, spawning up to the top left-hand corner here as our blue Zerg. He goes by the name of Liquid TLO. And spawning down to the bottom right-hand corner, a young phenom himself performing extremely well in the past Intel Extreme Masters challenges. Will he perform well here? He goes by the name of MVP Dream.
MVP Dream, what a guy. He beat TLO in Katowice in group stages as well last time. He beat him 2-1 and is currently leading this series with a 1-0. He went 4-1 in group stages last time and then shot himself all the way up to the quarterfinals through winning the group. And that's where we saw him demolish Daisy 3-1. He took out Parting in the semi-final, which was a massive victory there for Dream. And I became a fan of his play. I knew who he was before, but become a fan of himself and his play after IM Katowice. And I'm very happy to see him here once again. but it's time for TLO to perform, and it's not good. It's not good at all for your tournament if you open up 0-2 with your first two games.
Yeah, not at all. And to come back to what you were saying about Dream, I have to, you know, echo those sentiments. He impressed us so much at Katowice due to the decision-making he was taking when it came to pulling his opponent's army out of position, then attacking from other locations.
Yep.
Really, really solid decision-making, and I am actually kind of scared as to what we might see out of Dream here with the new tools that Terran has at their disposal.
That's right. And well, opening up Command Center on the low ground, no fear from Dream here. Of course, it is open to a couple of early spawning pool builds. If you do that, you can die quite early.
Yeah.
No fear from Dream. Just Command Center first, Barracks on the high ground, and we should be seeing him, depending on how he wants to play this game, take a gas very shortly. It is starting to run past the time to take a gas. Or he can just open up three Command Center and not give a damn.
Yeah, he can quite easily go for that as long as he's walling off and getting a few Marines out here and there, maybe even a bunker at the front. He should be fine and dandy. But for now, he's going to take both of his gas guys, just catch up a little bit, recuperate some of those losses that he, because he didn't have one of those gas guys initially.
Yeah, usually you want to take a gas pretty fast after the Barracks has been put down and then start mining away from a single gas. But with throwing double gas down, we're most likely just going to see him shoot towards a factory in Starport as fast as he can here and then open up maybe with just Hellion Banshee, could be Widow Mine, could be whatever, but with double gas coming down so early on, we'll see.
Yep, a lot of options still open to our Terran player, but meanwhile, TLO behind all of this, he's just been playing standard. He's grabbing himself two queens here, the first two just to get his production going, just getting a few drones out as well. Not looking to really go for any early aggression here against Dream, but I mean, depending on what Dream does and depending on what TLO scouts, that option is still kind of open to him.
Yeah, this Overlord should be fine. There is a gap in between the main and natural where the Overlord can sit and wander peacefully, and he should be absolutely good to go. Behind this, we do have, of course, the factory coming down. Reactor probably coming down next on that barracks, and the good old switcheroo ready for those reactor Hellions. TLO playing quite normal. One thing to note, though, is that we've seen a lot of development from Zerg players and Zerg versus Terran when it comes to Heart of the Swarm. Mm. Zergling, Baneling, Mutalisk, Zergling, Baneling, Infestor just don't cut it as much anymore. We've seen a lot more Roach-heavy plays, and likewise going over to Terran, we've seen a massive increase when it comes to playing mech.
Yeah, that mech play, very, very strong indeed. But Dream, this is kind of what we expected from him, that third command center going down, so he can just play very, very economically here. Really mining very, very little gas, just trying to eke out that command center super, super quick off the back of this tech, and you know, he could quite easily produce those Hellions, and there they go. But TLO behind this, he's actually not stopped producing queens. He's going up to six queens very quickly.
And in Dream's eyes, this is, to be honest, a little bit scary. You know, despite not really seeing what's going on, he does see the drone on the third base, which means and makes a little bit more sense for him considering all the queens are out. But, oh, we actually have a bit of a bunker block there, and that's going to be quite frustrating. And I was going to say that that could be a little bit scary upon not seeing the third base, but with the bunker going down, he had clear intentions to prevent a third from going down here. But look at that. The early gas that we saw from double refineries is not invested into a starport early on. Mm. It's just for a couple of Hellions, and then, or not really, to build a factory up, should I say, into Stim, and then double engineering base.
Wow, looking to make this game go at least long or either some kind of weird 1-1 timing, but for the most part, this is going to help him out quite a lot in terms of really kind of leaping forward into the game. Unless TLO is able to keep up, he doesn't actually have any evolution chambers down just yet. So eventually, if he doesn't actually get that going soon or doesn't put on a massive amount of aggression, which he doesn't look like it, he could fall back a little bit.
Yeah, it was an interesting playstyle from TLO to go completely gasless and then just, you know, completely saturate both bases, and then all of a sudden go, boop, four gas. Mm. Speed is the first 100. Overlord speed is the second 100, so we can go in and scout his opponent. And then very shortly, as the gas starts to incline here, we should see double evolution chambers, and there they are coming down. And I am interested to see whether it would be Ling or Roach upgrades. But upon seeing the Baleness coming down, that means that we're going to be seeing Zergling upgrades come out. Mm. Why would you put a Baleness down if you were going to rely on Roaches and Hydralis? So, an interesting choice here from TLO to go for this style.
Yeah, we might see him just sweeping in with Zergling, Baneling, Mutar, or even another tech choice in that layer phase. But, you know, I love the addition of the quick speed here from TLO, or relatively quick speed for those Overlords, because this is going to give him so much presence. And here he goes, scouting into his opponent's base right now, seeing every single little bit of tech his opponent has.
And it's not just that either. It's, think about all the Overlords that are going to go around the map now. He can spread creep wherever he chooses once the layer is done. He can now spread these Overlords Force to spot these fast medivacs that come from all over the place. So TLO opening up his map control a lot here with these Heinz as well, looking to creep spread. So a smart choice. And to be honest, Overlord speed was probably, if not one of the most underused upgrades in the entire Wings of Liberty. But it now has moved down to only hatchery tech. You do not need a layer. And that's opened up people like TLO. Look at TLO's map control. It speaks for itself here.
Such amazing amounts of vision here. And even if they do get threatened by like a Viking wandering around, easy peasy, just run away for a while. Very, very good here. As for now, does pick off a Hellion. Does see even this third landing at exactly the right time. And behind this, he's getting a ton of drones. He's getting a layer out. Why is he getting that many drones? Well, because he can see the whole map.
Yeah, he scouted his opponent play for a very greedy build, double engineering bay before Barrax added on, third command center down as well. So TLO's not really looking to go ahead and build a lot of units. But of course, with this moving out, he will start to build and morph banelings very shortly here. Does have Queen and a Spinecrawler protection for now to buy some time. But this is not a super major threat here from Dream. It's more of a, I'm going to pick off some creature tumors. I'm going to make sure you're not droning all the way up. And TLO should be fine just dealing with this, but it is an annoyance, of course.
Very much so. Killing off the active creep tumor is a big, big hindrance here. Indeed, we'll be able to get quite a lot from even the Queen. Second one may go down as well. One Baneling moves into the fray here and actually forces the lift up, even the afterburners being ignited here, so you can try and find another place to actually put on some aggression, but Zerglings are always going to be there, as are the Banelings, actually.
Yeah, and that's a bit of a bad drop there. Of course, three Queens, and it's very difficult to... Oh, he actually loses that minivac. I was going to say a bit difficult to drop into that position, but there was a couple the Lings that run by towards the third of Dream that picked off two mules and a couple of SCVs as well, but it of course was cleared up relatively fast, but a bit of a slowing. But look at that hive, such a fast hive here for TLO off three bases, going straight towards the spire, going straight towards the greater spire here, upon realizing that his opponent really doesn't have a massive infrastructure this.
I was not expecting that quicker hive at all, but I mean, just going back to that drop, TLO was so well prepared for that. He had the three queens positioned straight for when his opponent was actually going to push in, and really good focus fire on the initial medevacs.
Well, this game is starting to go in one direction, and that is rather late here for TLO. He's taken a fourth base. It is immediately picked up and cancelled in the bottom left there. He's speeding medevacs all over the place. It actually, as you can see, the cancel. The drone's still there, though. Wasn't picked off. Another drop heads towards the north side. The one good thing about going for a fast hive, of course, getting the fast hive, and you are now on three bases, not spread around four, so it's easier to defend, if that makes a little sense. It's one of the upsides of going for such a fast tech, with the downside is you don't have as good as economy and as much gas as you'd like. Yep. But
can be a little bit of a scary situation. But for now, he does have... Well, we'll be able to kill off this medevac. But that's a really cost-efficient drop there from Dream. One medevac for... Well, one Marine for one Baneling at a time. Really, really good. And it looks like TLO wants to try and apply some extra pressure himself, but every single choke he runs up against, it's cornered off.
Yeah, I'm super interested to see how this fast greater spy is going to work out here for TLO. Down at 138 supply, incredibly low. And very shortly, as 2-2 nears completion, the heat is going to get turned up. It's going to get hot in here because Dream's going to mount the pressure. He's going to start dropping all over the place. He's going to move out. We already see two drops on the map. His main army will move out very shortly. Is TLO... Oh, dear.
Oh, this could be catastrophic.
I don't think he has enough. There's Banelings right there. He hasn't got enough to pick it off, but he'll definitely scout it early on. And, wow, that's a fast greater spy there, TLO. And we'll start to see, extra starports come down, Viking production begin, because he has to prepare for this.
Yeah, you got to give it to TLO. Really great spread in terms of Zerglings to be able to defend this. Meanwhile, another drop's actually going to go down. Clear up that watchtower, but still Zerglings everywhere from TLO trying to hunt this down. Corruptor, you're not going to catch that medevac, my friend. Go away. As for now, he speeds off into the distance.
Now we do have the army moving out near 2-2 completion, the greatest spy about to finish there. And extra starports have been thrown down, so just super standard response here from Dream. Not started Viking production yet, because he has a big army. He doesn't need to add two Vikings. Two Vikings right now doesn't do anything to this.
No.
So just increase the strength of the army he's got, do as much damage before the Broodlord Infestors actually take to the sky and start to control space. And if Dream can somehow find himself to pull out TLO out of position, get a drop on this left-hand side, move through killing units after units, and then switch over to what he wants, that'd be the best approach.
But Dream for now setting up him very, very good spot in front of his opponent's base on two flanks here. Actually moving into the third as well, engaging in the middle. Good fungals actually land along with some banelings catching a lot of that. And he's forced to actually bring back the entirety of the flank that was going up to the third here to try and defend this as well. But there's so many Marines, so many tanks well spread out. Meanwhile, Zerglings actually ripping apart a lot of the SCVs at the third base there of Dream as well. But Dream just powers on forwards, but the Broodlords should be able to help.
TLO traded all his Infestors, Lings, and Banelings there to buy enough time to get these Broodlords out. Yes, it kind of was a hold, but he lost a lot of gas there, and he doesn't have that much money. Ooh. He does have this fourth base that is ready to go, but look at how many units are just streaming out here for Dream. 3-3, fourth command center on the way as well.
He's got 13 Marines in production at any given point in time, along with the Vikings that are now being produced. The income is pretty darn good here for TLO across the four bases that he has accumulated. Yeah. But Dream, well, he's yet to actually take his fourth. He's going over to his fourth right now. Okay.
All right, so this, you know, Dream attempted to do more damage than that. He didn't do as much damage as he wanted. He didn't trade off a lot of army, but that's what TLO wants as well. So not the best attack there by Dream, but he's about to make things a little bit harder here for TLO. Great creep spread from that overlord to deny that fourth base. But Vikings are out, man, and if these Broodlords are out of position, they're not Corruptors protecting them. There are no Corruptors on the map at all.
Yeah, this is going to be a little bit scary here. Those Vikings, they need to go down, but I don't think the Infestors are going to really have the energy or the time to be able to set them down during all of this assault. Once again, a good couple of fungals land on some medevacs there to be able to shut those down for just a little while, maybe weaken them a bit, but the banelings roll on in, yeah. It's just not enough.
This is over here for TLO. Drops down in supply, and Dream just overpowers his opponent. And the one thing to note is this style is looking weak. TLO is looking weak because of the Infestor change. It's so difficult to pin down Marines with the new Infestors. The fungal growth that comes out, the Marines are so fast they can dodge a lot of it. And then, of course, with the tanks just bringing all the Infestors down that he lost so early on in this game.
Yeah.
Dream picks up a convincing win.
GG, indeed. Dream looking very, very impressive there. There was not really any gimmicks to what he was doing, just constantly dropping around the map as best he can do. Once he's accumulated that massive, massive army, then he can easily push through straight through the middle of the map and give really hard time to TLO.
TLO, unfortunately now, guys, is 0-2 in games, 0-4 in maps. Not the best position to be in. On the other hand, though, Dream now goes 2-0 in his group. He beat Golden 2-1 before, and with a victory, a 2-0 victory over to TLO, he tops the tip-top of his group now with a couple of other players, such as MVP, Stefano as well, that's won his game. But right now, at this point, it is Dream with 2-0 in first place in Group D.
Yeah. So, guys, we are going to send it over to our analysis desk with Jorasar, QXE, and Harstam for game number two.
Harstam looks ever so slightly different at the moment as he has been replaced by Targa, but now taking a little bit of a break. Cheers, guys. I have to say, it was a pretty convincing victory there for Dream. But yep. Before we get into that, let's talk a little bit about how that game started off.
Well, Dream opened up with a command center first into barracks, double gas, but he didn't do kind of the typical double gas transition where you go into, you mine a lot of gas, you go straight into Cloak Banshee, that's really the only way to use that much gas. Mm-hmm. He goes like one or two SCVs on gas early on and gets a relatively fast third command center.
Yeah, I would call this a very greedy build and a very risky build. Like, he gets some map control with the Hellions early. He also kind of knew what TLO was doing. But overall, I think it was a very greedy, but in the end it paid off anyway, so. TLO didn't do anything about it.
Yep. Sadly. Dream had he had good presence on the map with his early SCV.
Yep.
He was checking for that third expansion, trying to see what TLO was going to do. When he saw the drone come down, he blocks it with the bunker, delays that third expansion a little bit more, and I think he had a pretty good idea of what was going on. Could have shifted that build a little bit, maybe instead of getting the third command center, transitions into a starport or second factory to be a little safer.
And he should have gotten a Viking. Like, he already knew about the Overlord speed, because he saw it earlier.
Yep.
And he saw some of the Overlords moving around on the map. Like, why would you start dropping everywhere? TLO was dealing with it almost perfect, except for some minor miss micro. Like, he got out-multitasked a bit, because Dream is a multitasking beast. But why not make a Viking and then just push the Overlords back? And you can drop and make TLO blind.
No, that's a really great point, actually. A lot of the drops that Dream had coming in, I mean, TLO, I think, lost two queens earlier on, but on the whole, he actually handled the drops from Dream really quite well in that game.
Yeah.
And a lot of that did come down to the really nice spread, the Overlord positioning, seeing those drops come in advance. And he basically held his own for most of that.
And that's definitely a pretty hard map to defend drops on in some of those positions.
Yeah, there are so many places where the drops can come from.
Yeah. Mm. So there's so much surface area around your main, and also the distance from the main to the fourth by ground is tremendous, but the distance from the main to the fourth by an air is so, so small. So you can attack the fourth, pick up, go into the main. TLO doing a great job of splitting his units up, but
yeah,
just not...
He had units everywhere to defend for the drops.
Basically.
And, I mean, if you see the drops coming a mile away, if you don't defend it, you're a really bad player. And I think TLO did this almost perfect. Some minor mistakes.
Yep.
But another thing I want to point out, I think he teched a bit too fast to Hive.
Yeah, to Broodlords in there.
Yeah, to Broodlords. It was a bit too greedy of him. I mean, he had a really good economy. His creep threat was decent. He defended the drops well. But in the end, Dream somehow still out-macroed him. And
yep.
I think it was because he was too greedy.
Sure. I think also it would have helped even though TLO was able to defend the drops relatively well, I feel like that was taking away a lot of his focus and making his macro a little bit weaker. It's hard to macro and also defend drops from multiple angles.
I agree.
If TLO had been left alone when we saw that Broodlord transition, there would have been more Infestors, more Broodlords, more Lings, more Banelings. But because he was kind of on his back foot for so many minutes during that game, it just made it that much harder.
Yeah, but our Korean Terran of Dream's class, he will never let you get to Broodlord CC.
Yep.
He knew exactly when the Greater Spire started. He already had a drop there. He sees everything. So he knows, okay, I have this and this amount of time, and I have to push before that. And that's what he did.
Yep. All right, guys. So that was a pretty comprehensive victory there for Dream, who goes 2-0. TLO, unfortunately, not having the greatest time here so far, but he has plenty of matches to try and make up for that 0-2. In the meantime, though, we're going to be heading over to Rachel up on main stage, who I believe is going to be introducing our next match.